Welcome to Revelation Reimagined, where we get to dig into this great book of Revelation. We pose questions about what the prophecies of Revelation mean, what it means about the end of time and the end of the world, and just ask this big question of what is the big picture of Revelation? We want to welcome you to this online exploration. We are up to session number 5. And with me today, I have Roman Halupka to my left, Peter Hughes further along, and Michael Mahanu at the far end. My name is Darren Croft. We are 4 Seventh-day Adventist pastors who love to study, dig into, and share the book of Revelation. In our last session, we discussed the 7 seals of Revelation, and we ended on what was really a bit of an unexpected cliffhanger with half an hour of silence in heaven. And we saw 2 big questions emerge. And those questions were, how long must this go on? And the answer was, be patient a little longer. And the next question was, who can stand facing the coming of Jesus? And the answer, well, we got a really clear answer on that. Anyone who is with Jesus and has accepted Jesus can stand on that day. Today, as we dig into Revelation chapter 8, 9, 10, and 11, we're covering a big area of Revelation, and these are some of the most contested passages within Revelation. So as we approach it, we want to approach it with a degree of humility, recognizing that we believe we have a big picture to share here, but as we look at the trumpets and the little scroll and the 2 witnesses, we also recognize that we're all learning and growing in our understanding of this great book. But we do want to talk about what we do see here. And where we're going to begin today is looking at the roles that Jesus takes in the book of Revelation. He takes different roles as we progress through this book. And let's just take a step back from these chapters. We'll see how it emerges in these chapters and just take the grand overview of the book. What are the different roles that you see Jesus taking here in Revelation? We've got a graphic that'll come up. Peter, do you want to just introduce us to this?
Yes. In chapter 1, 2, and 3, we understood the role of Christ as high priest. But while he was high priest, he was also sitting on the right hand of the Father in heaven, and he was the king in waiting. So he's high priest and the coming king. But then when we get to the midpoint of the book, where we are introduced to the conflict between Satan and Christ, Jesus changes his role to be Michael the archangel. He was first introduced to us in Daniel, and now he is the one who goes to war against Satan and brings the end to the conflict that has been unfolding. Many people don't understand that Michael is Christ. Mm-hmm. And the final, when we get to chapter 15, the role of high priest comes to an end because the temple is closed and probation finishes for people on the earth. So that is the time when Michael is fighting against Satan. And the conclusion of that is in chapter 19, when Christ comes for the 4th time in the book of Revelation, and he is coming as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He brings a conclusion to all of the conflicts that have existed during the last 6,000 years.
Yeah. Now, Michael, with a name like Michael, I've got to pick on you on this Michael one. You might have another comment you want to make, but what do you understand that the name Michael is telling us?
Yes, it's understand. It's interesting that the word Michael in Hebrew actually is made up of 3 words, mi, ka, el. Mi is the question mark. That's how it is written, mi, ka, el, Elohim, who is like God. And so even the name suggested that it's someone equal with God. That was what I wanted to mention, just to continue what Peter was saying, because I have done some research across different churches. I looked up somewhere around 13 Bible commentaries done by various Bible students, theologians. And it looks like at the theological level, there is agreement that Michael is Jesus, right? And in those commentaries, they say clearly, you know, according to their study, they came to the conclusion there is none other but Jesus, because the Bible allocates such an important role to Michael. So if he's not Jesus, that means there's a conflict between this important archangel and Jesus, and they are kind of, there's a conflict of interest between them. So by us saying that Michael is Jesus, some people are misunderstanding this identification, in a sense that we believe that Jesus was created. We don't believe that. Well, we believe that Jesus is not God. No, we don't believe that. We don't believe that. What we believe is when we put together all these Bible verses where Michael appears in a combat.
And this is just Daniel in Revelation. This name appears nowhere else.
Appears in other parts of the Bible, in Jude as well, and appears again in a fight with Satan. So every time there's a battle, Jesus takes this name as Michael. And it should not surprise us, because we know that in the Bible, Jesus has many names. Like, you know, when Jesus was born, Gabriel, the angel, said Emmanuel. But Jesus is never called Emmanuel. But in that position of a newborn, Jesus is called Emmanuel, God with us, because God has come and was born. So it should not surprise us that actually Jesus is called Michael in those circumstances where he's fighting the forces of evil.
Yeah, as our Michael mentioned so many times about this historicist approach to the book of Revelation. So we already in previous sessions mentioned, you know, how the things are developed in history, in history of Christian church. So, and we also on the first meeting mentioned that this book is about Jesus, is about revealing Jesus. So Jesus had to change the role in the period of history. So that's the reason what is happening. You know, as he starts as a high priest, he finishes as a King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So that's the result of the role of Michael, what you mentioned right now. So that's this progression all the time, this progress in it is very important to notice also in the roles of Jesus.
Yes, and so you see this development.
I'm going to cut in on you. You've often mentioned about Joshua and he, when he was with the children of Israel at Jericho, he met somebody. You can you tell us who you...
Well, he first introduces himself as the commander of the Lord's army.
Yes. Who's the commander of the arms?
And it's the Lord himself. It's Jesus.
None other. I just wanted to mention one verse, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 to 18, where we have the closest identification. When Jesus comes, he comes with the voice of the archangel. I mean...
Yes.
That is such a good identification. Why Jesus, when he comes, does it come with the voice of God or with the voice of, you know...
Son of God.
Son of God. He comes with the voice of the archangel. So here we see that overlapping of terms. So when we call Jesus an archangel, it doesn't mean that he's a created being. It means he has a certain function. So that we are looking at Jesus' function in this great battle.
No, that's a good insight. And I think what we're seeing here, we're not saying that Christ is that, and then he's not that, and he's this. What he's saying is there are elements of the role that change over time, but he's all of that and more.
Correct.
And yes, there's a time comes where his work of mediating for his people comes to an end because he's coming to collect his people. So that high priestly role is completed, but that doesn't mean he's no longer our high priest. He's still our high priest, but it's conveying truth to us. And the uniqueness of Jesus is he is king and priest and all these other things. So let's come to the seven trumpets themselves. Now, trumpets symbolize what?
Warnings.
Warnings. Anything else?
Judgment.
Judgment.
And again, we go back to the Old Testament to see where do we find seven trumpets.
Uh-huh.
And this is very important because we go back to Jericho.
Yeah.
And the seven priests with the seven trumpets, and they had to surround the city once every day on the seventh
day,
seven times. And that was God's judgment towards that city that was obstinate, rejecting God, that wanted to kill the spies, wanted to kill God's messenger. So definitely it comes from that, as God is pronouncing his judgment toward the world that is rejecting him.
It's a sit up and take notice sort of message, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that is something beautiful telling us about God. God is not punishing at once. Just after something. He's warning, all the time warning. And in fact, the whole book of Revelation is telling us about many, many times in time and many, many ways of warning people, just to stop them, just to shake them a little bit.
Well, it's the act of a loving parent that says Absolutely. To the child,
yeah.
don't touch the stove, it's hot. Or as they get older, you know, be careful on social media because there's people out there yeah. that we don't want you to make contact with, or, you know, don't get scammed. And in a way, this is God's don't get scammed chapters, isn't it?
Yeah.
Can I just add a little bit to what Michael was talking about? He said when Jesus comes, he's coming as the archangel, Michael, but he's coming with the voice of God. And he also said, and the trumpet of God.
Mm.
So that seventh trumpet, which is what we're looking at in this particular segment of our study, is the last trumpet.
Mm.
And it parallels, it happens at the same time as the last plague.
Yep. Yep.
So it's bringing everything to a conclusion. And it is Michael who is coming with the voice of God. So he is bringing the combat, the conflict. To an end.
We'll elaborate on that a little more in a moment, because what you have with the seven churches is the view of history from the people of God.
Yes.
Then with the seven seals, you have the view of history from the progression of the gospel through time. Yes. The judgments are God's judgments through time, aren't they?
The next step in the sequence.
So we're looking at those same general eras, but each time we're looking at it from a different perspective. So let's share this graphic, Peter, that you will enjoy talking to, and I'm sure the others will too. So here we see, again, that chiasm structure. Tell us more about what we're looking at.
Well, we looked at the seven churches and we saw that they were reversing parallels. The first church was similar to the last church,
yeah.
or a similar message. Look at the middle church in this case, Thyatira. Thyatira was a corrupt church, and God was warning that I will kill her children with death.
Yeah.
But he identified the seventh seal as the black horse. Black is the color of apostasy. And when we were looking at the seals, white was the color of Christ. So you had the white of Christ, then you had the black of Satan, and that black of Satan will lead to everlasting death.
So that fourth pale horse.
Yeah. Yes. And the seventh trumpet was darkness on the earth. It was telling you that the fourth trumpet was the earth was not in light, the earth was in darkness, and it needed to come back from that darkness.
Yeah. So you know, there's so much symbolism in these trumpets that, you know, we're not going to unpack each little symbol in there. That's for another forum, another time. But this gives you that you know, that overview of how the sevens fit together. So as you look at these sevens and as you look at the trumpets, so let's look at the first trumpet just for a moment. So the first trumpet is found there, wrong page, there we go, chapter 8 and verse 7. The first angel sounded his trumpet, and there came hail and fire mixed with blood, and it was hurled down upon the earth. A third of the earth was burned up, a third of the trees were burned up, and all of the green grass was burned up. What do you notice in that first trumpet?
It's a partial judgment or destruction.
So we've got
it's one third in one third. So it's not like what we'll discover in the plagues, where the plagues are universal. These are just partial.
Yep.
Have we mentioned the fact that in Scripture the two significant numbers in Revelation can be 3 and 4?
Mm.
3 highlights Satan, and 4 highlights the work of God. And when you get to the fact that the fourth trumpet is referring to the people of God, yet that same fourth, the elements in that fourth trumpet were also talking about the first church of God, the Church of Israel.
I'd just rewind a little, because I think I'd temper the 3 represent Satan. I'd say the 3 can represent the counterfeit of Satan, yes, or the true 3 in terms of, yeah.
Good pickup, yes.
I think it would be very good to notice here that, because we are just changing the words. Sometimes we say warning, sometimes we say judgments, partial judgments.
Okay.
And, you know, that's very important to understand that still those judgments are the warnings, in fact. God is agreeing that some kind of a punishing people for what they did, the wrong decisions. But in fact, that's just to shaking them a little bit, to help them to find a way. It's still time. It is not the moment, the final judgment, the last judgment. No, that's the reason we call partial judgments, you know, because God wants to shake them. It doesn't mean, well, we say that the first trumpet is mainly targeting the nation of Israel. Yes, they rejected Jesus, they rejected Christ, but at the same time, they still have individually opportunity,
of course, yeah,
to convert, to change their mind, and to follow Jesus. So that's the reason because I know how normally people understand the word judgment. It's the finish. That's, you know, there's a sentence and it's done. Well, in fact, it's not done. It's just warning all the time.
Yeah, I like the idea of judgment equal warning in this case,
yeah,
because this is not judgment to finish it,
yeah,
as you've said. This is judgment to try and draw people back.
Absolutely. We still have Jesus, the same Jesus who loves us and who does everything that the people will be saved.
Now, you've said this first judgment, you know, picks up on Jerusalem, Israel.
Yeah. Yes.
Now, that's drawn from Old Testament symbolism, where trees and plants can represent God's people. So yeah, with each of these, there are these fairly deep symbolism that we're drawing on, but we won't always have time to go into. There is an element, of course, here where the backdrop scene to these 7 trumpets are this heavenly scene where the censer is hurled down on the earth, and then you have fire being the element that comes through all the 7. Does judgment work in this case? Do the warnings work?
The warnings are warnings because you have the chance to change. God asked you to be an overcomer. He wanted you to repent. He wanted you to change your course in your life and in coming to an intimate relationship with Him. And that Israel had rejected Him and they crucified Him. So He punished the church, the people of Israel. But then for the people that came after that generation that crucified Him, there was the chance for them to embrace Him again, to understand what they had done. So you have this series of warnings in the 7 trumpets. And with a warning, you can reverse direction. You can turn, and in chapters 6 and 7, we learned that the law of God, the love of God, is represented in white. But the colour that defines Satan in chapter 12 is red. So that if you want to embrace the sin and apostasy of Satan, you can go that direction, or you can, if you choose in your heart, to go back and embrace Christ. So the trumpets are warnings, and it gives you the chance to change. You can go back and embrace Christ, or you can continue in apostasy and be in the company of Satan.
So we see these warnings, you know, starts off focused on Israel. Next one moves to Rome, which we don't have time to go into the symbolism there. But we see a very similar structure to what's come before. You know, there's 4 plus 3,
yeah.
Just as there was with the seals. There's 6, then there's a pause before the 7th. And so we see, again, it just emphasises that these do give us the same, the same thing from different angles.
Yeah.
So let's come to chapter 10, and we're going to take the time to read some verses out of chapter 10. And short little chapter, but so much in it. Chapter 10, verses 1 and 2 says, "Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head. His face was like the sun, and his legs were like fiery pillars. He was holding a little scroll which lay open in his hand. He planted his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and he gave a loud shout like the roar of a lion." All right. Who's this mighty angel?
All of the symbolism points to it being a match to chapters 4 and 5 of Revelation.
Yeah.
Where they highlight the role and ministry of Christ and who it was that was sitting on the throne. The rainbow was around his head. This rainbow is around his head. He shone like the sun. And that, again, the glory of God was like the sun.
Yeah.
Christ was like the sun. So it is suggesting that the angel, the messenger, was actually Christ.
Mm-hmm. Which is even echoing back to chapter 1, isn't it?
Yes. Mm.
And we can go even to the book of Daniel, chapter 10, chapter 12.
Yeah.
Again, there is a description of this mighty angel.
Mm-hmm.
And that description is leading us to the same conclusion. It depicts Jesus in a very important role there.
Yeah, yeah. All right, let's keep reading. Let's go down a few more verses, down to 5 to 7. It says, "Then the angel I had seen standing on the sea and on the land raised his right hand to heaven, and he swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heavens and all that is in them, the earth and all that is in it, and the sea and all that is in it, and said, there will be no more delay or no more time. But in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished, just as he announced to his servants the prophets." There's a statement in here that I want to ask you about, because there's this statement, you know, no more delay, no more, the Greek is no more chronos, you know, I've got my chronometer time on my hand here, no more time. What's that getting at, Roman?
It shows that we are reaching the end of history. We are closer and closer, and that's the warning. That's really, if there will be no more time, if I know that I have not time, so I try to rush with everything to do, because just to make it, to manage to do something, we are still talking about warning. So as it is the warning, so it's just opening our eyes. There will be no more time of just tolerating something, what is happening.
And I guess it goes back to the book of Daniel, because in the book of Daniel we find these prophecies,
yeah.
Especially Daniel 8:14 with the longest prophecy of the Bible. So when we put that prophecy on a timeline, actually it reaches the beginning of 19th century, and then after that there's no more prophecy. We don't have any other prophecy. So there's no more time, there's no more prophecy, there's nothing. We are living in an extension of time of God's grace.
So it's a cluster, because it's not just one, isn't it? It's a whole cluster of prophecies that terminate in that period. And if the seven trumpets, if they're all about warnings, even the time element, the prophecy element is, they're warnings, aren't they?
Yeah.
So it says then in verse 7, when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished. We all like a good mystery. Is this a mystery that's not to be understood or to be understood? What is this mystery?
It's a mystery that is understood. God's people, the people who have that intimate relationship, who are overcomers, will in the end understand the truth and have the relationship, because we, in chapter 7, we talked about 144,000. Mm-hmm. And the 144,000 are those who go to war for God, to stand in the light and truth of his love. Mm. And that, so they are the overcomers. And this is a warning that many people will not contemplate or understand the warning, but there will be people who do, and I would like you to be one of them.
Yeah. Michael?
I guess if we go to what Apostle Paul says in Colossians chapter 2, verses 2 and 3, it will give us even more information, where Apostle Paul says, my purpose is that they may be encouraged in heart and united in love, so that they may have the full riches of complete understanding, in order that they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom of knowledge. This is just an amazing verse. Apostle Paul, when I get to heaven, I need to go and talk to him.
Yes.
So there are two mysteries in the Bible. This is what we often say, the mystery of iniquity, how sin could appear in a perfect being we can't understand. And the mystery of God, how God decided to give his son for these worthless people to die for us, to take away our sins so that we can have eternal life. This is the mystery of God. And the mystery of God is being proclaimed, that is the gospel, the salvation in Christ, the salvation in Jesus Christ.
That's strange that God calls this, through his writers in the Bible, mystery. At the same time, he wants us to know it, to understand it.
Yeah.
It's a mystery in the sense that who can understand the love of the Father? Mm. I don't think I can understand that. When he decided to give his son to die for us, while Apostle Paul says, while we are sinners, we hated God, we are haters of God, and he decided to make this enormous sacrifice. Who can understand? Who can explain that? So how can I not fall in love with such a God? So this is why it's called the mystery, because the human mind can't process this type of love that is beyond our, you know, I love you if you love me.
Yeah.
That's the type of thing that we are here on earth. You know, if you give me something, attention or whatever, I love you, I appreciate you, but for God is the opposite. We hated him with passion, and he gave his son to die for us.
Yeah. I want to come to the next verses here, verses 8 to 11, because this picks up some interesting elements as well. Then the voice that I heard from heaven spoke to me once more, go take the scroll that lies open in the hand of the angel who is standing on the sea and on the land. So I went to the angel and asked him to give me the little scroll. He said to me, take it and eat it. It will turn your stomach sour, but in your mouth it will be as sweet as honey. I took the little scroll from the angel's hand and ate it. It tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth, but when I'd eaten it, my stomach turned sour. Then I was told, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, languages, and kings. This is, you know, we've just been talking about the mystery of God and the gospel going forward, and now this is saying there's a connection to a sweet and bitter experience. What experience is this telling us about?
Well, for sure, we are in the end time. In history, it leads us to the second coming of Jesus. And you know, that time, well, the sweet is always this beautiful truth of the gospel, what Michael was explaining so long and beautiful what it is. So that's sweet. So how is it possible that the sweet something is bitter? Mm. Well, that's something, well, it's bitter as we digest it, or maybe the reason that there is, we are surrounded by so many people who are absolutely against, don't understand, don't accept. Well, anyhow, we come through some problems, persecutions, and that's the result of this. It's still sweet. Yeah. It's still sweet. But you know, there is the result of the situation that makes us absolutely bitter.
Okay. It's the process that is being described as a two-stage process.
Yeah.
In 1844, people stood in the truth of God, but they didn't get the message quite right. They said Christ is coming, and he's coming back to this earth, and he's going to cleanse it with fire. That in scripture isn't the correct understanding. So God said to the people of that time, you must prophesy again. In other words, you've got to study your Bible and go out and give the full truth.
So you go back to that 1840s period, you know, history would tell us that it was anywhere up to, you know, perhaps as high as 20% of the population in the US was on board with this expectation of the second coming of Christ.
Yes.
And obviously they got it wrong. Yeah. Now, actually, they weren't the first ones to get it wrong, were they? Because if you go back to the disciples,
yeah,
they believed that Jesus was going to set up this earthly kingdom and they would rule with him and everything would be great. And then he died on a cross.
And that was bitter.
But that was bitter.
That was bitter.
They expected him to come in their lifetime.
Yes. And then they also, you know, through the coming of the Holy Spirit, were told, you know, go and prophesy again.
Yes.
So that message, it's a message for now as well.
But Daniel had given the world many timeline prophecies, as Michael was explaining.
Yeah.
But now we've come to the time when there is no more timeline prophecies. Mm. So the immediate thing that we need to do is to understand and overcome and embrace Christ in truth.
Yeah, we're in that final period of history. So the other thing I do want to just pick up on quickly, this little scroll. Have you got any idea what I know there's lots of ideas of what the little scroll is. Mm-hmm. What's the little scroll?
Probably we have to go back to the book of Daniel, and we know that there's an intimate connection between the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is just a continuation, expansion of certain prophecies from the book of Daniel, and we'll see actually in chapter 11, clearly 1260 days. This is part of Daniel chapter 7, all right? So we see as we read the book of Daniel in chapter 12, that there is a part of the prophecy of the book of Daniel that was sealed. And God says, seal it, because it's not for you, it's for the time of the end. And that was God's message, just sealed it. So in the book of Daniel, we have many of the prophecies explained, like what is the head of gold in chapter 2? Well, we know it was explained, Babylonians. What is the chest of silver, the Medo-Persian, and Greece and Rome? So it's spelled out every single prophecy that is given there for hundreds of years ahead of time. But then there is one prophecy that was never explained. That is Daniel 8:14. And everything actually goes around that prophecy that remained sealed, the only one in the book of Daniel that remains sealed. And now it's something that is open, is unsealed, we can understand. So that prophecy, actually, we do fully understand now, we can fully explain, but it came with the joy of proclamation of the gospel, and then the bitterness of the fact that the events that followed were not exactly as they believed.
I guess it fits with what Jesus says in the Gospel of John a couple of times, where sometimes we use prophecy to try and connect to the latest headline to predict what's around the corner. And yet Jesus says, I've told you this beforehand so that when these things take place, you might believe. And I think in that sense, prophecy is less about being, we get the big picture of what's coming, but we don't get every little detail. What we're given is, when it happens, you'll see it and it'll help you believe. It'll build your faith. And I think that's good to remember that. Revelation 11, we come to the two witnesses. We have, again, the measuring that takes place, that's symbolic of judgment. Just talk about these two witnesses in chapter 11. What do you make of these two witnesses? What do they symbolize?
You mentioned judgment.
Mm.
Well, judgment means that you have been judged by your actions and your beliefs, and God has either found you in harmony or out of harmony with him. And in Scripture, in the Old Testament, the two prophets that highlight the law, which establishes the principles that God asks us to keep, and judgment are Moses and Ezekiel. And the fact that he goes back and he quotes Old Testament prophets, that they are still relevant through the book of Revelation, tells us that he hasn't changed any of his principles. He hasn't changed the law, and he won't change his judgments.
Mm.
So that the message is, if you're going to accept God, you accept him for what he says he is. He doesn't change through time or history. He is consistent, and he is a God of love that wants to embrace you.
Mm.
But he has set a set of principles that we should keep so that we don't do any hurt or harm to any else, other people or to ourselves.
And I guess that sense of, witnesses establishing the facts, we could also talk about, I guess some would say maybe the Old and the New Testament, or, the Holy Spirit is also a witness. We are witnesses, and all of those things come together to establish God is just, God is good.
There are multiple twos.
Yes.
In this.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
So let's come then to Revelation chapter 11, 15, verse 15, where we see the seventh angel finally sounds his trumpet. And it says, verse 15, the seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever. So Revelation 11 is preparing us for what comes next. What do we see about, what do we see around the corner here with Revelation?
Second coming.
It is the final battle of Armageddon.
Mm.
It is the coming climax of this battle. Yes. If you were to take time and go back and read Revelation chapter 6, if you read Revelation chapter 11, if you read Revelation 16, and you read Revelation 19, they are all second comings of Christ.
Yeah, the pictures of it, yeah.
Yes, but they are relevant to the message of that episode. So up to chapter 7, they highlighted the law.
Mm.
Then in chapters 8 to 11, it highlighted the warnings. Then in chapters 12 through to 16, it highlighted what the final judgment of God will be on people who have persecuted his people. And then it all comes together in chapter 19 when Christ comes again and all of these second comings reach their fulfillment.
Yeah. And I guess it's that sense that the culmination of the warnings is, what's going to happen at the end?
Yeah.
Christ is going to come. his kingdom's going to be established.
Yeah. Yes.
So hear the warnings.
Yeah. I want to look at verse 18. The nations were angry and your wrath has come. The time has come for judging the dead and for rewarding your servants, the prophets and your saints and those who reverence your name. It's an amazing statement here because we are told that actually God's people have not received their reward. So it's revolutionized the whole thinking that when someone dies in Christ, the soul of that person goes to heaven, receives the reward, is with the angel, don't worry, everything will be fine. Here we are told that the saints and the prophets, they have not received their reward. They will receive their reward when Jesus comes.
Yeah.
So it's such a clear, and we will look into that a little bit more in chapter 20, because after Jesus comes, there's not a millennium of peace, as you know, many Christians believe that you know, this peace of tranquility and harmony will take place on earth. But the book of Revelation in chapter 20, it tells us that a judgment is starting in the moment Christ comes.
Well, and while that's the troubles on earth are going on.
Yeah, this is the verse that he says, the time has come for judging the dead. So I understand from these that the dead have not been judged. Mm. So that means there is no hell, because if there is hell, that means there is a judgment that took place. So you can't send someone to prison before you judge.
Before judgment, that's true.
So. It just the book of Revelation is correcting some traditional beliefs that Christianity has, and probably this is why many Christians don't even dare to touch the book of Revelation, because it just contradicts all these traditional beliefs. But yeah, I thought this is important. It's part of this seventh trumpet that makes clear what is going to happen then.
No, good insight. Peter?
Can we raise the last verse of Daniel? Daniel struggled to understand the timelines that God revealed to him, unfolded to him. But in the last verse, he was told that he would rise to his inheritance at the end of days.
Mm.
In other words, he was going to sleep in the grave until Christ comes back again. Which is reinforcing exactly
the same idea. Exactly the same idea. Thank you very much, Peter. So Daniel talks about the same scenario, the same understanding, and John just confirms it. There's nothing new in the book of John.
There's a consistency.
There's a consistency between the prophets of the Bible.
Yeah. No, good insight. We've come to that time where I guess we need to just wrap up with a final thought each. And as we wind up with chapters 8 through to 11, we've laid hopefully a little the foundation for chapter 12, because as we go on into chapter 12, we're going to see much more clearly revealed the forces that are arrayed against God, the Antichrist forces. But that's for next time. Gentlemen, as you reflect on these chapters, what is it that you believe God is seeking from us? Roman, I'll let you go first.
Well, that's what we mentioned so many times. The first part of the book of Revelation, up to 11th chapter, is revealing what Jesus is doing for us all the time. And summarizing, we can say, he's warning all the time. He's just inviting, pushing us even a little bit by some partial judgments to go on the right way, accept me. Well, this, it comes to my mind now, back, you know, this sweet taste of the gospel. And you know, even sometimes we are going through the bitter experiences. The warning is for us, for everyone. It doesn't matter that, you know, I belong to this group of people for sure. There's no warning for me, for everyone. And that's what counts really, because starting with chapter 12, we know that we'll start completely with a different picture. Now we are learning more about the other side, what he's doing, Satan, devil, the dragon, many other names. We'll study it in the future. So that's what is important. For me, I can see here again the Lord who is waiting for my decision. And that's time to take it.
Yeah.
Thanks, Roman. Michael, I'm going to go in a different order this time.
All right. Many times when you read the book of Revelation, we stumble over this language that is so hard to understand. And it goes into a kind of a grotesque explanation, like these locusts that are prepared as a battle, like horses, and they sting like scorpions. it's a grotesque. And we do have to understand this language in terms of how God is seen on earth and what is happening when people act against him, making alliance with the forces of evil. But look, many people are overlooking chapter 8, verse 4. That is a beautiful verse. And the smoke of the incense, together with the praise of the saints, went up before God from the angel's hand. How beautiful is that? So no matter what scorpions and no matter what grotesque, what will happen there, you know, how serious it is, when the prayer of a simple child of God goes up to heaven, that prayer is paid attention to. Mm-hmm. And it's taken before the Father, and the Father knows that prayer. And I think this is what we have to emphasize in the book of Revelation, that God does not abandon his people. He doesn't turn away from his people, no matter outside the storm and the fires and how bad it's on the outside. But when we are in that relationship with Christ, our prayers are listened to, are answered. We are in a safe place.
Thanks, Michael. Peter, last thought.
In the last episode, we looked at the four seals, the first four seals that Christ, the Lamb of God, opened, and it highlighted colour. The horse's colour was crucial. The first seven chapters of the book of Revelation highlight the importance of the law of God, and the people who overcome the law are given white robes of righteousness. Christ is described as light and purity. All of these represent the white of light. Mm. The second episode, which was from chapter 8 to 11, tells us that we are all sinners. We have sinned because Adam and Eve sinned. But it is a warning that if you are a sinner, you can change. You can turn back and embrace the light of Christ, the love of Christ, or you can continue forward into the apostasy of Satan. In the third episode, chapter 12 to 16, as I mentioned just a little bit before, the Battle of Armageddon unfolds, and God describes the judgments that are going to be on those people who have walked with Satan in the darkness of apostasy. They haven't wanted to embrace the light. And the final episode is chapters 19 through to 22. It talks of the everlasting death. That if you are judged by God in chapters 15 and 16, and you suffer those plagues, you will not come back from those plagues. Your life has finished. You have enjoyed this life on earth, but you haven't enjoyed the everlasting life that God offers. So, my friends, understand that God is in many ways telling us simply how the book unfolds.
Mm.
Thank you, gentlemen. On that note, it's time that we finish with prayer. So just join us as I pray. Dear Jesus, we pray to you, the one who brought light into this world, and we pray that we would hear the warnings that we have looked at briefly here in Revelation, and that we would take hold of Jesus, the one who is the light unto our path and a lamp unto our feet. So, Lord, may you continue to guide us as we go on in our study of Revelation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We hope that you'll come back again next time and come to our next episode. Next time we are into Revelation chapter 12, where we get to see the battle behind the scenes, the battle that's going on between good and evil, Christ and Satan. Have a read of it before we come together next time. See you then.